nose in front of you. Please stand. Until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples,
the sheet that is spread over all nations, he will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from Revelation, chapter 7, verses 9 through 17. I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried in a loud voice, saying, salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders, and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, who are these, robed in white, and where have they come from? I said to him, sir, you are the one that knows. Then he said to me, these are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes, made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple, and the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more, thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our sequence hit is number 686. It says 688. Pretty wrong on that number. 686.
Oh,
Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
A time where those family and friends who wanted to say a couple words, maybe I invite you to come forward and share thoughts, memories, questions.
My name is Taylor Clark. I am Biggie's first grandson. Maybe not his favorite, but his first. Danny had that. And I am really, really glad I got up here before Brother Gerald came up here, because there's no way I could follow behind that man. And it is a true testament to see all the people that have showed up for my papa and my grandmother. He was a loved man. He was a great man. Character is defined as what you do when nobody's around. Class is described as what you do when people are around. He was the epitome of character and class. And if there's one thing in this life that I've learned, is how to be a good man. I remember we would always go to Papa and Grandmother's house for Christmas. And I was 7 years old. And my hero was John Wayne, because my papa loved John Wayne. We watched all the movies together. And this one particular Christmas, my cousin Danny broke my heart and told me that John Wayne had died 15 years earlier. And I just cried and I cried and I cried. But little did I know that I was in the presence of my true hero for 35 years. He told me the other day, he was laying in bed, you know, he was a huge Georgia fan. He told me if they keep playing as bad as they've been playing, I was going to be laying in bed right beside him. And how fitting for the Florida game. One last heart attack for me. He's loved. He's missed. But his memory will live on. And I'm so very blessed that I got 35 years with my hero. And if any of y'all knew him and played for him, I'm going to leave you with two final words. Chop, chop.
name is Balani, and I am reciting this poem for my papa. Remember me. Don't remember me with sadness. Don't remember me with tears. Remember all good times shared throughout the years. Now I am contented that my life was worthwhile, just because I know by loving you that I made you smile. When you are walking down the street and you've got me on your mind, I'm walking in your footsteps, only half a step behind. So please don't be unhappy just because I'm out of sight. Remember that I'm with you every morning, noon, and night. Thank you.
I am Danny. I am the firstborn grandchild. Taylor says I'm the favorite, so I knew I wouldn't be able to get up here and just say what was in my heart, because I wanted to break down, so I wrote something out. Some people knew him as Diggy, or Coach, or Boss, but I knew him as Papa. I'm his firstborn grandchild, and from the moment I was born, he called me his princess. And he treated me like a princess for the last 36 years. Some might say he spoiled me. I don't agree with that, but Taylor thinks he did. He and I had a really special bond. I may have been the only 9-year-old watching A&E's America's Castles on Saturday morning instead of cartoons. We loved to watch and discuss what kind of castle we would build if he won the lottery. He was my cheerleader, my role model, and my hero. He may have seemed like a tough guy to some, but to me, he was always gentle and kind and ready to give a big hug. When I chose to play soccer, he showed up at games ready to cheer me on, even though he knew very little about the game. He learned the rules and the names of my teammates. He instilled in me the importance of practicing hard and being a great team player. He would tell me that you play like you practice, so leave it on the field, whether it's a consequential game or just a scrimmage. He set the bar really high when it came to me finding a partner. He and grandmother were an amazing example of a love built on mutual respect and true commitment to one another. They truly adored each other. They welcomed Nathan into the family with Papa standing at the altar with my dad to show his support for my pick. Papa and grandmother remain a beautiful example to us of eternal love and devotion. When my first child, Amelia, was born, Papa was there to dote on her just as he doted on me. I reluctantly shared the title of princess. Connor and Eleanor followed, and Papa wrapped each of them with unconditional love and attention. My kids know that there are no rules at Papa's house. If they want ice cream at 8 a.m., they can have ice cream at 8 a.m. Papa and grandmother wanted their house to be a place of joy, a place where we could escape from the craziness of life to spend time eating ice cream and enjoying one another's company. Today, that place will be a little different. But we will continue to remember his smile and his laughter. We will remember his big blue eyes that sparkle when he told a funny story, and we'll remember his big and warm embrace. We will go on because he taught us to be brave and strong, holding a place in our hearts for the man that meant so much to so many.
Hey, my name is Buster Smith, and I just thank the good Lord that I had the privilege of having Diggy Garland as a young man to help hold my life. When I was 11 years old, I think it was about 11 or 12, maybe 11 and 12, he was my football coach. And, you know, the game of football. all have a lot of similarity in life. Through digging, he taught me so much, more than football, he taught me so much about life. And you know that life is not easy, neither with football. And Diggy was a hard coach, I'm trying to tell you. Probably the hardest coach I've had through high school, Lord, my freshman year of college. But I learned so much from him. And you know, he taught me so the values of hard work. You know, you go out there and you work your rear end off, and if you get knocked down, you get back up. You don't let me feel sorry for yourself. You get back up and fight some more. And he instilled in me to, you know, to want to win. And I am just so blessed to have that in my life. You know, it carried on through my life, and even today. You know, it's part of who I am today. And I'll share this with you. When I was 11 years old, and our high school coach, Coach Boyd, that's who Coach Diggy, he was a legendary coach at Toledo High School. He came and spoke to our group on Wednesday afternoon. And the topic, the whole subject was Diggy Garland. And talking about the character of Diggy Garland and thinking, you know, positive things to have about him. And he couldn't say enough about Diggy Garland. And I'll never forget this, he told the story of one of the few games, I guess, they ever lost, you know, when Diggy was playing. And they got off the bus, and Diggy Garland was crying because he got beat. That's how bad they wanted to win, you know. But anyway, I just have to get up here and thank the family for that I had Diggy in my life, because he had a tremendous influence on my life. You know, it was a blessing.
Enjoy these times where people get to share, people that know and love, the loved one that we're celebrating today, in this case, Diggy. Because obviously, people know him way more than I know in this earthly world, and I can pretend that I know him very well, but instead I'm free from having to talk about Diggy in this life, and I can talk about Diggy in his life today, which is great. Because Diggy has passed out of the Great Tribulation, as we just heard from Revelation. Right? He's gone through the Great Tribulation. Not talking about you specifically, Angie, but you know, he's got football players that he's dealt with, he's got work that he's dealt with, and daughters and granddaughters, and holy moly, that's a lot to go through in life, right? To be that person, that character, that class, it's a lot. To be lifted up as the example of a godly, righteous person. And he performed admirably. And now he's passed through the Great Tribulation. And one of the great phrases is to the kids right here now, I know most of you don't pay attention, but they talk about when they went and had their robes, white robes, that were washed in blood and they became bright white. I don't know about you, but usually when you wash things in red, they don't come out bright white. I remember when I stayed with my grandmother, she washed my red shirt with my underwear and socks, and I had to wear pink underwear. Time I was there with her for a long time. But this image is great. We have the blood of the Lamb. That when we're washed in the blood of the Lamb, our robes come out white as snow. And this is where Dickie is. For Jesus has prepared a place for him. He said, "But I prepare a place for you. It's finished. When that castle is ready for you, that if I win the lottery, I won the lottery now, Jesus, that I'll come and I'll take you to that place and I'll dwell with you forever. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. When it's done, I'll come get you." And that's a promise that he makes, not just to Dickie, but to each one of us. All of us, and it's not a matter of if, it's just a matter of when. When that dwelling place is finished, he will come and bring us to that place and bring us to himself. And so we, this day, do rejoice that God has brought Dickie near to him. That God is blessing him, and he is growing from strength to strength in the love and service, indeed, that he's passed out the great ordeal. And no longer is there sorrow or pain or suffering or tears. No longer is there sickness. No longer is there even death. Because the glory of the Christian life and the resurrection is that there, in death, life is not ended, life is just changed. That beautiful poem that we just heard from this young lady speaks powerfully to that. Right? The life carries on, and it's a new and glorious life. One in which we are built up forever and ever in God's glory. And so this day indeed we do mourn with those who mourn. We weep with those who weep. We comfort, we care, we surround those who feel lost at a great and wonderful person in this world. A world that's lost a great man. Husband, father, grandfather, mentor, coach. We sorrow this day, but we rejoice indeed that the life he has in Jesus is a life that will go on forever. And that in that, we might be able to put our hope and our consolation and indeed our care for the days not only to come over the next few, but in the years to come. The promise that indeed Jesus gives to us through his resurrection and his life. Amen. Baptism, let us stand together and proclaim our faith, saying the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let's stand in your place. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge.
Prayers of the People are found on page 497 of the Common Prayer. For our brother David, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for thee, and dry the tears of those who weep.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Give our brother eternal life.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother to the joys of heaven.
Hear us, Lord.
Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints.
Hear us, Lord.
He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother. Let our faith be our consolation. And eternal life, our hope.
Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our brother David, who was reborn by water and spirit and holy baptism. Grant that his death may recall to us your victory over him, and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your waters, Lord. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow your leaven. And where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
To invite you on behalf of the family to the interment that will be immediately following at Stephen's Memorial Garden. So if you're not lined up now, get lined up after the service and follow us out to the cemetery there. There's probably, it looked like at least in the hall from what I could see, plenty of food back there. So before you get to it, probably you can grab something to eat on the way. But I do welcome you here. Just wanted to give one final instruction about communion, Eucharist, the Lord's Supper, whatever you call it in your church. And here at St. Matthias, this is an open table, which means all who know Jesus and are baptized and want are welcome to come to the altar to receive communion, the body and blood of Jesus. This is sort of the perfect place to come. In our theology, all the saints are gathered at the altar with Jesus at the head. And so all the saints of past, Dickie, and every other saint, past, present, and even future for that matter, come and gather around the altar as we celebrate this great celebratory feast together with him. So you're certainly welcome to come forward to receive communion. If you don't wish to receive communion, if you'd like, you can just come forward still and put your arms over here, over your chest like that, cross them, and I'll be happy to give you a blessing instead. We're pleased now to have Pastor Gerald Bain to be singing Amazing Grace as our offertory anthem. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
How sweet the sound. Oh, that- When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we acknowledge days to sing God's praise. And when we first
prayer is a prayer, and it's on found on page 361 of the book of common prayer. If you'd like to call it off, please stand. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is a right, good, and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For to you, our faithful people, our Lord, life is changed, not ever. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy,
holy,
holy Lord.
God of high and mighty, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he gave thanks to you, broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption of Father, and this sacrifice of praise and thanks to him. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the Holy Spirit and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Hallelujah, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore,
these are gifts of God for you, people of God. Post-meeting prayer is found in your bulletin for this prayer. Almighty God, we thank you that in your great love, you have fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Pray that this sacrament may be to us a comfort and affliction, and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom, where there is no death, neither sorrow nor crying, but the fullness of joy of all your saints, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. To your servant with your saints.
For sorrow and pain are no more, nor the sign of life everlasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal. Formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even in the grave we make our song. Alleluia, alleluia. Hallelujah.
Give rest to our lives, to your servant, with your saints, for your sorrow and pain are no more, not the sign of life everlasting.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant. Acknowledge we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own form, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in life.
Amen.
May the God of peace who run again from the dead, our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work, working in you that which is well-pleasing in the sight and blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you now, and I in you always. Our closing hymn is hymn number 178. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give thanks to the risen Lord.